with a degree of anonymity. I had a chat with Arwa Damon earlier today about her report. Here it is. Arwa, you touch on this in the story about, you know, how a 28-year-old man is running this sort of a show. Tell me a little bit more about that and about his inspiration for doing so.
Well, Michael, the interesting part is that he actually never told his mother that she was his inspiration, and he said that it was because he didn't want her to think that the show was about her or just about her, because once the project actually got underway, he realized the scope and gravity of the problem. And we asked him how it was that he ended up being so aware and compassionate towards the plight of women. And he said that it was because of the education that he received, that he was fortunate enough to have been well educated, well brought up. And that is why he believes that education is such a critical part. And that is the real point of the show. It's to educate people about the plight of women, to try to bring about some sort of change and put pressure on the government to take action.
And he expresses confidence that change can happen. I mean, what's your sense about that confidence? He says it will help women and perhaps change male attitudes. What chance? He's up against some pretty entrenched attitudes.
He is. He's up against centuries-old traditions. He's up against this mentality that women are to be treated as commodities. He's, to a certain degree, up against the authorities who don't necessarily prioritize women's rights or women's issues. But he clings to this belief that if he can get the message out there, get it out there strong enough, reiterate it with the fact that he has these religious experts, scholars, legal experts, human rights experts on the panel to really enforce that message that what is happening to women is wrong, that he can begin to at least plant those seeds of change.
I'm curious what it was like for you when you were speaking with these women and you saw them without the mask, and what your impressions were of these ladies as people.
Michael, their faces were naturally aged way beyond their years, but they had very firm handshakes. What's really striking about them when you hear them talking wearing the mask is, as we were saying in the piece, the body language, the way they're hunched over, their hands are twisting nervously. One doesn't need to understand what they're saying to hear the trauma in their voice, to just listen to their breathing. You have to remember that their entire lives, these women have been told not to ever address these issues, that they're taboo. And finally, they're given this opportunity to speak out. And at the same time, they were saying they were relieved, but they were also petrified.
Yeah, okay, that was my next question. Let's touch on that a little bit more. Once the mask is off, the interview is done, the message is out there, they have a sense of relief, but at the same time dread in terms of their safety.
They're worried, of course they are, even if their identities are concealed, because they're worried about the consequences. There have been countless cases where women have been forcibly returned back to their families, where their families have tracked them down and in some cases killed them, in other cases beaten them, forced them to go back to their husbands, and these wretched lives, really beyond the scope of one's imagination, that they're having to live. So the fear is very real.
Now, what about how the show is being received by women, by men in Afghanistan? Did you get a sense of the popularity or otherwise of the show?
Well, Michael, the show has actually only aired one episode so far, although they have taped a total of five. But according to what Sami Mehdi was saying, the feedback they're receiving has been fairly positive. The show appears to be quite popular. The TV network that it's airing on, TV One, is actually a very young station. It's only been broadcasting for around 9 months, and they're really trying to push the boundaries. One of the many comments that the show was receiving, though, was viewers questioning how they were going to be able to sustain the program, because it is so difficult to find these women who are willing to speak out, even if their identities are concealed. And so what Sami Mehdi was hoping was that the more the show is broadcast, the more women are going to be aware that they have this platform to speak out, so eventually more would be coming forward.
Yeah, very good point. Just finally, I'm told you tried the mask on during the shooting of the story. What was it like? Is it a weird sort of sensation?
It is, because we are very used to being able to openly express our opinions and make statements, and we're brought up to, as women, to fight for our rights. And to realize that for women in countries like Afghanistan and similar areas around the world, the only way that they can speak out and claim their identity, claim their lives back, is by putting on a mask. And in one way, as Sami Mehdi was saying, it's like they have to go into a prison to be able to actually speak out.
There's some great reporting there from Ahwa Damon. We'd love to know what you think of that story, or any story for that matter. Just go online, share your thoughts. The team's Twitter name is @Backstory. Mine is @HomeCNN. You can join us at facebook.com/BackstoryCNN. Fans get a note from me before the show, get the Backstory on Backstory. Just click over to 19,000 fans or followers or likey things, whatever they are. How did you ring in the new year, by the way? Did your celebrations involve an ancient bell? Did they involve a drag queen? Well, ours involved both. Well, our crews anyway. We'll show you after the break.
Today on Inside Africa, it's the